In this segment, we will derive the trapezoidal rule via method of undetermined coefficients. So what we're going to do is we're going to derive the trapezoidal rule by method of undetermined coefficients by saying that, hey, let a definite integral be approximately equal to c1 times f sub a plus c2 times f sub b. Now, one might say that we have already derived trapezoidal rule by looking at the area of a trapezoid or by saying that the function is approximate by a straight line and we can find the area under the curve of a straight line. And why are we trying to solve the problem of deriving trapezoidal rule by using the method of undetermined coefficients? The reason why we're doing this is because this will form a good basis for you to understand the two-point Gauss quadrature rule and also show you the motivation behind it. So what we are going to talk about in this particular video here is going to be only about trapezoidal rule, but you will see later on, if you go to the playlist, the applications of doing it this way, as opposed to jumping right away into a two-point Gauss quadrature rule. So let's go and see that whether we will be able to find or derive trapezoidal rule by assuming that the integral of a function will be simply given by multiplying the value of the function at a by some value of c1 and multiplying the value of the function at b by some value of c2. And these are the undetermined coefficients. And that's why we called it the method of undetermined coefficients. So let's go and see that how we're going to do it is by saying that, hey, let f of x equal to a naught plus a1x be exact by the formula. So what we mean by saying that is, hey, we're going to say that, hey, whatever I get from this formula right here will be exactly the same which I get from integral calculus for this particular function. Will that allow me to find what c1 and c2 are? So what that means is that I have to find the value of this straight line function exactly. So I'll get a naught times x plus a1 times x squared by 2. And I'll put the lower limit to be a and upper limit to b as required. So I get a naught times b minus a plus a1 times b squared minus a squared by 2. But what would I get from the formula? From the formula, which is c1 times f sub a plus c2 times f sub b, I'll get c1 times, hey, what is the value of the function at a? This a0 plus a1x, the straight line which I chose, it'll be a0 plus a1 times a. And what would be the value of the function at b? It'll be a0 plus a1 times b. And what we started with was saying that, hey, I want this to be exactly same as this. And you might say, hey, this is only going to give me one equation, but I have two unknowns, C1 and C2. How do I go about doing that? So let's go and see how we can get to that to find both C1 and C2 just by having one equation. So what we're going to do is we're going to equate what we get from exact calculus, which was this quantity right here. And then we'll see, say, hey, what we got from the formula? We got this. And we have now two unknowns, C1 and C2, but we only have one equation. How we can get around that by saying, hey, let me collect the coefficients of A naught. I'll get C1 and C2 for the coefficients of A naught. And for the coefficients of A1, I get C1 times A plus C2 times B. Now I can say that, hey, since when we said that, hey, let the formula be exact for a straight line, we did not put any limitations on A0 and A1. It could be any arbitrary straight line. So if that is the case, then the only way this whole expression right here can be equal to this expression right here is if the coefficients of A0 and A1 are the same. So what that means that you will have C1 plus C2 equal to B minus A. And then you will have C1A plus C2B equal to b squared minus a squared by 2. So this is equation 1 and this is equation 2. So what I'm going to do is I need to find c1 and c2. These are two simultaneous linear equations, but let's go through the process to find it. So one of the ways I can do it is I can take the first equation and multiply both sides by a. And what the reason why I'm doing that is so that I can get rid of c1a from here if I subtract the two equations. So I'll get c1a plus c2a is equal to ab minus a squared. That's equation 3. Now I'm going to subtract equation 1. I'm going to subtract equation 3 from equation 1, let's suppose. So what I will get from there is that I'll get c2b minus c2a, because this term and this term will cancel. And from here, I will get b squared minus a squared by 2 minus ab minus a squared. So let's see what we get here. We get this quantity right here. So this turns out to be b minus a whole square by 2, while on this side it will turn out to be c2 times b minus a. So this is a little bit easier to go and find out. So what's going to happen is that let's go and go to the next slide. Repeating what we had c2 times b minus a is equal to b minus a whole square by 2. So we can very well see that C2 will turn out to be this quantity right here. We already know that C1 plus C2 is B minus A. So if we put that in the formula, we get, we'll again get C1 is equal to B minus A divided by 2. So both the values of the coefficients of C1 and C2 are B minus A divided by 2. So if we look at the original equation which we had, or the formula which we had, assumed for our coefficient of undetermined coefficients, so we had this as our original formula, and then we found out what c1 and c2 are. So we get b minus a divided by 2 times f sub a plus b minus a divided by 2 times f sub b. And you very well recognize this. This is nothing but your trapezoidal rule. So if you could write it like this. A is b minus a times f sub a plus f sub b divided by 2 as well. So what is good to point out about the formula which we derived is to look at both the forms which I showed you. I showed you that, hey, it is b minus a divided by 2 times f sub a plus b minus a by 2 f sub b. What that simply implies is that if we have, if we are integrating a function from a to b, this particular form means that, hey, we have the value of the function a, and then if we look at the midpoint, which will be a plus b divided by 2, that gives us this width here, or these two widths here, to be b minus a divided by 2 and b minus a divided by 2. So that makes it this rectangle right here. And if I want to look at, hey, what area does this? This is b minus a divided by 2, and this is the value of the function at b, that's the height. So that gives me this rectangle right here. So that is this part right here. So you can very well visualize trapezoidal rule to be a sum of two rectangles, as opposed to the area under a straight line. So if we had something like this and we drew a straight line instead, we would say, hey, the area which is represented the trapezoid rule is the area of this trapezoid, which is exactly the same what we have here. So the area here and the area here which have been calculated will be exactly the same. And this is also necessary to understand if you are going to understand two-point Gauss quadrature rule. And that is the end of this segment.